Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I just want to make a quick video, let you guys know I've got my bright light here on my face. I just got here to the Philippines. It's been about 48 hours now, a little more than that. Of course, we're 13 hours ahead of the East Coast of the United States, so it's about 11:30 on Sunday night here. I've been meaning to make a video, as a matter of fact, yesterday morning, but we had all kinds of stuff going on. We had a dengue fever scare here with one of the children, but it turned out, praise God, we prayed and everything's great. And it was turned out to be just the flu or whatever for one day. As a matter of fact, it was a complete quick recovery and turnaround. The child is perfectly healthy today after just less than one day of being very sick. So praise God for that, brothers and sisters. This is the new place I'm staying at. for the next 3 months. Praise God, I'll be back in the States in May. In the meantime, brothers and sisters, while I'm here, I'm planning on, by the grace of God, we're going to start on the third orphanage. For those of you who watch the videos, who know. So once I get settled in here and get over the jet lag, we'll be doing it. We'll start working on that. The Lord has just been dropping stuff on me like crazy since I got here, brothers and sisters. And I'll be making videos about that. more wisdom and understanding about the new world order, the return of the Nephilim, return of the the Antichrist to rule and reign. And brothers and sisters, the Lord was just really, if you think about it, what happened, everything that happens is like a type and a shadow. We can see types and shadows and lots of things in history and in the church, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, but. One thing I was just looking at today was how Constantine merged state and religion. He merged state and religion. It seems to be that that's what's coming back. I've made lots of videos over the time that I've been making videos, brothers and sisters, with bits and pieces here and there. And by the grace of God, the Lord has really given me the wisdom. Maybe that's what, I end up writing the book about, is I've started on two or three different books and just one to get, to come to a complete idea. Maybe it will be a complete breakdown about all these things that the Lord has been showing me about these obelisk and, the return of the New World Order and all these things. But what I've said in the video just the other day was how you see the three. The Lord had shown me that one interpretation of the Florida Lee is, and part of the understanding of that is three horns, three kingdoms uniting. And then I had mentioned in that video or another one after that about you have the Vatican, D.C., the District of Columbia, and the City of London. Not London as you know it. There's another thing called the City of London within London. And D.C. is a District of Columbia within Washington. There's D.C., and then there is the Vatican, which is a city-state. So we have these three centers of power, like three horns, brothers and sisters, coming together. And when we look at stuff like Constantine, we see the Holy Roman Empire after that. We see, really, Constantine has really made himself like the first pope. The first pope is really Constantine. There's all these people. There was a bishop at Rome, but there was a bishop in Antioch. There was a bishop in Smyrna. There was a bishop in Ephesus. There were bishops in lots of the cities. They had a bishop, which was like the head of all the churches in that district. And that's how the church was formulated even before the book of Acts was finished being written and on into the letters of, when John wrote the Revelation and all that, he was a bishop in one of the areas. So, and Polycarp took his place after John died. And then after him was Irenaeus. So anyway, in that one area. So there was no one bishop who was the ruler over all the body of Christ in the whole world, which became formulated in his common sense in the kingdoms of men, not in the kingdoms of God, the kingdoms of men. Rome was the center of the power of men at that time. So therefore, it's just common sense that when the secular world, the Babylon, the government system, Revelation 18 is Babylon, the government system. Revelation 17 is Babylon, the religious system. The woman, the whore that rides the beast. The whore is religious Babylon. And the beast is the government of Babylon, but there's also a person, the Antichrist, who is also a beast, and the false prophet, who is a beast. So these things have multiple levels, and I need to make a video covering all of this and try to encapsulate it all in one video in as short as time as I can. But it's like this, brothers and sisters, a culmination of the things I've been talking about for the last 4 years or whatever, 5 years on YouTube, 4 years, is that there's symbolism, brothers and sisters. There's the lowest level, and then it goes higher and higher and higher level of symbolism. So when you and I might see something of Florida Lee, we may think of New Orleans, or you may think of, some people think it's even used in reference to the Trinity, something like that. But there's deeper meanings and different levels and deeper understandings at the highest level of what the devil's people are trying to do. And I've said this before, I'll say it again. After the Tower of Babel, the languages of the world were confounded. God confounded the languages of the people. Why? Because not because they could literally build a stairway to heaven, but because the Tower of Babel, they said, let us make a name for ourselves. They wanted to make themselves, you know, man is God. We can get to heaven without God. It's like the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They said, oh, we can go this unauthorized backdoor way into the wisdom of God without going through God, through the tree of life. Same thing with a Ouija board, seances, tarot cards, any kind of magic and all those things. It's saying, hey, how can we get the wisdom of God, the gnosis, or like Gnosticism, how can we get this gnosis, this wisdom of God, without going to God? That's when you get the Masons, you've got the Rosicrucians, the Knights Templar, all that. All these groups, which are all interconnected and descendants of down, you know, to each other, all interconnected, the mystery, Babylon, it's the same religion. So, brothers and sisters, it goes back. There's the classic evangelical interpretation of Daniel is that the kingdom of Antichrist will be based on the statue of Nebuchadnezzar's dream. The revived Roman Empire will be the kingdom of the Antichrist. Now, like I said, what the Lord has just dropped on me today is the emergence. Of course, you know, America was founded in really a Judeo-Christian godly way, even though we have the Masons and all that too as the founding fathers, but an age of enlightenment and all that. But, you know, God, religious pilgrims, like I've said before, my ancestors came to the U.S. as religious pilgrims from persecution in England. Lots of people did in those days. That's what they came for. Lots of people came for freedom of religion. And that's why America, you know, was blessed and all that. As many true Christians came and prayed over the land and dedicated to God. And what the biggest part of those things, of the founding of the United States, was separation of church and state. Separation of church and state. Now, there's lots of Christians today who are confused when they talk about taking prayer out of school and they say, well, you know, we want to have prayer in school. And I want to have prayer in school too. The problem is like today, we have Muslims immigrating to the United States every area. Muslims are invading the United States, you know, different religions. And so when they come there and say, oh, we want to have your kids, do a Muslim prayer, people are outraged by that. So that's the problem we have, brothers and sisters, that America was founding, and the genius of our founding fathers is really that wall of separation where the state doesn't control the church, and we don't want the church to control the state in the United States. Because what if, you know, look at the Muslims, when they have Sharia law, what the Catholics did in the Middle Ages, you can study these things and see that church and state combined is very bad, and very, you know, religion and government combined as one. Kingdom of Antichrist, brothers and sisters, will be a combination of church and state, or religion and state, not necessarily church, not thinking of Christianity, but religion, a religious system combined with the state. And that's where the Lord was really showing me today that Constantine is a type of the Antichrist in that way, in the fact that he was given the word, in this sign, conquer. Well, of course, the Lord never told us to go around killing people and all this kind of stuff. The Lord Jesus Christ in the New Testament. No, in the Old Testament, most of you know these things, but in the Old Testament, of course, the Israelites were given specific commands to destroy specific groups of people because their bloodlines was contaminated with the Nephilim blood, and the people were offering their children as sacrifices and all this stuff, and God specifically wanted to clear out that holy land to prepare an area for the birth of the Messiah and all that. Those were specific delegated commands and situations through Joshua and Moses and those guys. Nothing to do with a general command to go around killing people. That's not for us in the New Testament as the body of Christ, as the church. As Jesus told James and John, when they wanted to call down fire on somebody, Jesus said, you don't know what spirit you're of, because I didn't come to destroy man's lives, but to save them. So brothers and sisters, that is what the Lord wants us to do in the New Testament, to save lives and not destroy them. And the Lord has given me lots of wisdom on that topic about evangelizing too, which I'll make more videos later. So on this topic, we see the coming merger of church and state, or religion and state. Now you can talk about Islam and all that. And we see in there's the spirit of Gog, of Magog, is really like Satan or a fallen angel. And that spirit will rebel again at the end of the millennial reign of Christ. The children of the tribulation saints, people who survive the tribulation, who do not take the mark, who are followers of Christ, are called tribulation saints. They will still be humans in their human body. They can still get married. They can still have children. Their children will need to get saved just like everybody else. And their children, some of them, will rebel against the Lord there at the end of the thousand-year reign of Christ. And they will be led by Satan and by this Gog and Magog. But that Gog of Magog is a spirit, a fallen angel, a principality. The one time when we see in Ezekiel 38 and 39, that is different. You can go read the text and see that it's not during the millennial reign of Christ. There will be another war, or the first war of Gog and Magog, under the this principality of Gog of Magog, which is in the region of Rosh, Tubal, and all this, Toblinsk, and Russia, the same people. These, the Scythian people, go look up and follow the history of that. It's the Russian people and the Iranians and other Muslim countries. They will try to attack Israel. Now, that is the spirit of Gog and Magog. But the thing that the Bible tells us in that text, brothers and sisters, in the King James, five sixths of the army will be destroyed by God. Only a sixth part will remain of all of these Muslims and the Russians who will attack Israel. So based on that as one connection, in my observation and opinion of the tribulation in the kingdom of Antichrist, Islam will not be a factor during the reign of the Antichrist. As a matter of fact, that battle, in my opinion, will lead to the peace treaty. The Antichrist will come to power because of that battle of Gog and Magog from Ezekiel 38 and 39. So I clearly believe and see that the revived Roman Empire, which could be an American, you know, most Americans are descendants of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire even covered Northern Africa and other places like that, lots of areas. You know, many nations are covered under the Roman Empire, the former Roman Empire. So even you got the eastern side, Constantinople and all that, and the Byzantine Empire, that's half the world. It was a part of the Roman Empire. So the Antichrist could be an American leader. Or still living in mainland Europe. But in my over 15 years of studying these things, brothers and sisters, in my opinion, the Antichrist will be of royal blood. He will have a royal blood claim to the house of King David, to the throne of David. He will have some Israeli blood and claim that right to be the king of Israel. He will also claim, you know, to have royal blood and a right to the throne of the European Union. He will have, you know, blood, royal blood from that side also. And so you will see the merger of church and state. That's where the Vatican comes in. Not Islam, but when you think about the spirit of Antichrist, you think about standing in the place of Christ. Nothing speaks louder than that, than a Christian leader who is in apostasy and heresy. So it's only logical and makes sense that, you know, all of these denominations, they're cult leaders. Like in the Philippines, there's one Apollo Siquibro. He's got between one and two million followers, most of them Filipinos, people around the world. But when you see the Pope has 1.2 billion Catholics in this world, it's much more highly probable that the false prophet and the standing in the place of Christ would come from the seat of the Pope because of the amount of followers that the Vatican has. It's much more powerful and influential than any other religious organization on earth. So it makes sense. Plus, when we follow types and shadows back to Constantine, we see in the Dark Ages and all that, we see that the Vatican, you know, Catholicism were the ones who were persecuting and killing people, and the Crusades and all that stuff. They were right in there in the middle of that, killing people with the Inquisition and all these things. Something that you might expect really like during the Tribulation, an Inquisition. Do you swear allegiance to the Pope? Do you swear allegiance to our dear leader, der Führer? You know, the Führer, like Hitler was the leader, the Führer, der Führer. So we can see that type and shadow of what the Catholic Church has already done through history. Merging of church and state. Killing anyone that doesn't bow, not to Christ, but to the authority of the Pope. You know, like what they did to the Huguenots, the Waldensians, these other groups, the Anabaptists, you know, were persecuted, well, really, you know, more by the Church of England. But Church of England was only, you know, Roman Catholicism without the Pope, under the authority as the, you know, King Henry declared himself, you know, the head of the Church of England. Now, the King of England, or the Queen today, and then her son Charles will be the head of, now they call themselves Defender of the Faith, not the faith, but faith. They remove the to move more toward a one world religion, uniting all religions. So brothers and sisters, the Pope is in the position and has the power and the history, the papacy has the power and the history of bringing all, you know, having the ability to bring all the world religions together. Islam will be taken out and taken care of as a force with the war of Gog and Magog. And it says that they will know that the God of Israel is the God. God will make a name for himself and show that he is the defender of Israel. So everyone's going to be in shock and awe of what God's going to do through Israel as the, you know, the kickoff of the Super Bowl known as the Tribulation. It's going to be the kickoff is the battle of war and Gog, the war of Gog and Magog from Ezekiel 38 and 39. So brothers and sisters, I see this coming together as the Lord showed me about the fleur-de-lis. You know, the Pope has three crowns. You know, and then it talks about, as I made a video the other day, there's three kingdoms are uprooted and one king takes over. That's the willful king, the little horn, that's the Antichrist. He will take over three kingdoms and unite them. Now, will it be one of these European kings? Could it be the North American Union? Could it be, like I said, I don't know, Scotland and Ireland, you know, the United Kingdom, Great Britain, has already been together for a long time. But you see, like I said, you can see the Pope wearing these three crowns. Pope Innocent, they have a big statue of him. They always have there where they make these European Union treaties and conferences. There's a big giant, larger than life, statue of Pope Innocent wearing the triple crown, you know, seated as a giant above all, over all the people there, the European leaders. I many people know this, many people don't. I don't know if I've talked about this. You know, the European Union headquarters is built like the Tower of Babel from the classic painting of the, you know, the incomplete Tower of Babel. And their motto of the European Union is, you know, many languages, one voice. See, referencing right back to the Tower of Babel. Besides, their building looks like the Tower of Babel. It references back to the overcoming the language barrier, and that's what I'm talking about. The symbolism that you say, oh, that's just nothing. That symbol is innocent. That symbol means A. But in reality, the symbol means, to the highest level of Satanist, the symbol means, you know, A, B, C, D. There's 4, 5, 10 different things that it means all the way to the highest level, always going back to Lucifer. So that, you know, you hear the surface meaning, or you hear one level or one degree, like degrees in masonry, you hear one degree, a meaning of a symbol. But there's many levels, and symbolism is what the devil used to overcome a God confounded the languages. What did they do? The devil comes out with symbols. That's why masonry is filled with symbols, allegories, all of these things to bypass the language barrier. So anyone in the world can see a big blazing star and say, oh, that's the sun. But really, it's the dog star Sirius that is pointing to, ultimately all the way to the illuminated one, to Lucifer is the meaning of the symbol. Brothers and sisters, and I could go through all this symbolism and run all it way up, show you all the different levels by the grace of God. That's what I'm praying to do, is to take a lot of, you know, I already know these things, but it's a matter of bringing them together and making a good presentation. So, you know, I'm not really one for doing slideshows. You're talking about hours and hours and hours and hours. And I like to put the information out and let people study themselves, you know, and dig into it themselves. So everyone will know, not just sit back and, you know, be fed, but here's a piece of bread, you know, and then you can discover those nuggets yourself as you would want to find out these different things. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless. We arrived safely in the Philippines. And I'll be keeping you posted. And Lord's been giving me so much wisdom and videos to make. I'll be working on it as my... I got a real slow internet connection. I'm supposed to have a faster one hooked up, hopefully, this week. So I can have no trouble loading my videos. God bless you guys. I'll see you soon. And don't let anybody put a spirit of fear on you. That's the biggest thing I hear from people. You know, when they watch all these wacky videos on YouTube, they get a spirit of fear. You know, they become afraid. Don't let any morons put any spirit of fear on you. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power and of love and a sound mind. 1 Timothy 1:7. God bless. 2 Timothy 1:7.